All right, well, E3 2015 hasn't officially started yet. And I think maybe Fallout already nipped the honor of winning E3.
November fucking 10th, 2015!
I don't even know where to start with this one. Yeah. We have a whole sheet of things to get through. Let's just talk right off the top shelf. Number one, we have a date. November 10th, 2015. 10th. This year, within a number of months.
How many months is that?
A handful.
Five.
Close enough that I am now going to have to reschedule holiday time to make sure that I have that week off. There is a free Fallout game out tonight if you want to just pick that up, which looks pretty rad. We'll talk about that in a little bit.
It looks so good.
Let's roll it back to the start. We had a long presentation. Todd Howard showed off a bunch of concept art and nonsense, and then they dove into the game. First thing we saw, gentleman looking into the mirror. Changing his face. Walk us through.
It was so... Okay, so you can play as any skin color, any... You can actually fix their face to make it look like whatever you want to look like. But what surprised me about this demo is his wife is awkwardly standing over his shoulder. And then they swapped her in, and it turns out you can play as a woman in Fallout 4. So those rumors were correct, casting.
Mm. Absolutely.
And this is where you make your character, and I think you can name them as well.
Yes, and this is in 2077, so this is the before the war happens, which is something we've only seen little parts of in the Fallout universe. After this, there's a sort of they definitely edited down the next couple of minutes of the early part of the game before the war eventually came to U.S. shores. One of the things they showed here as well was that you have a baby, and the baby is based off of almost like GTA 5 online style.
Parents.
Yeah, based on the parents. Conversations. Look at this. No more awkwardly zooming in on faces, Lucy.
Yeah, look at this. I mean, well, there's awkwardly zoomed in on that guy. But no, it's just, and it's fully voiced. Yeah. I think that's another big thing, is that all the main characters are fully voiced. And while the facial animations still look a little bit awkward,
eyes aren't quite as lifeless as they were in Fallout New Vegas. Kevin, what do you think about that aspect of it? Open world RPG games, fully voiced for a while, sort of, Fallout's always been languishing a little bit back, or rather Bethesda games have been. What do you think of that addition?
Yeah, this is really exciting. I mean, everything about the presentation was actually... Mm. Really getting me excited. I mean, sometimes maybe it's a little awkward the way their lips move and that kind of thing, or way their legs move. But I don't know. It seems like they've been actually paying attention to the RPG world around them and said, hey, you know what? The Witcher is doing this cool stuff. Dragon Age is doing this cool stuff. It's about time we should probably live up to these ideas.
And we saw some of this stuff in the trailer they revealed just a number of weeks ago. This all happens
terrifying.
Before the vault part.
Yeah.
And an interesting thing that happens in this one, which does exist in Fallout lore, is the idea of cryogenic stasis. There was Vault Zero, which I think was part of New Vegas's lore, which was one of the vaults in which somebody who had been around during the 2077 was able to come out. Usually you're the descendants, you are like great-great-grandchildren kind of situation. Whereas in this, the character you create, the mother or the father or the wife or the husband, come out of the vault 111 as them again.
The final survivor.
Yeah.
That vault.
And here we have our little Fallout 3-esque reveal of the landscape as well, showing off.
And it's not just brown.
Yeah.
No. That's another great thing. I mean, it's there's color. There's still a sense of wonder that's not just, oh God, everything's been destroyed and scorched.
Yeah. It's kind of like, obviously the world got destroyed and now nature's kind of claiming it back slowly.
Yes, and it looks like a lot more nature than what we saw on the West Coast in terms of like just even bushes and whatnot, or what we see in the DC area in Fallout 3. He also walks super nonchalantly for somebody who's just seen all of his friends and family die. He's looking all right.
The world I know is gone. I'm just going to saunter down.
All my friends are dead.
They pushed the idea of the third person in Skyrim as well a lot in their
you know, I really liked
stuff. Maybe it'll work a little bit better in this.
This isn't bad. I still look at that green font in the interface.
Yeah.
I think I'll be adjusting that when it comes time for me to play.
I'm sure they'll let you. And then, they show off this is Codsworth, the robot, which was the family's de facto mechanical slave.
So a cool thing there is that they said that they've recorded thousands of names.
Yes, for
the
child as well.
Yeah.
They've dumped in terms of voice acting.
That's really great.
Cool.
And then this is they were very quick to show that, these conversations, like in Fallout, are quests that you can walk away from, come back. You can kill him if you want. You can continue on with the quest, which was one of the sort of the main pillars of Bethesda's games was the ability to just murder anyone you want. The idea that you had all the choice in the world to do what you wanted.
And just like I wanted, look at those dialogue options.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Called it.
Yeah, and a nice bit of, just in terms of the voice acting, there, I just can't believe that a game of this scale is going to have all this. I like the way that it's also saying, you okay? It's almost like Witcher style, letting you know if this is a dialogue option with a different color that you're going to dive into for a little bit longer. But pushing on from this, we then saw later the gas station that we saw in the trailer the little doggy. Alexa, you must be very happy.
I'm really excited that you can command the dog. It sort of reminds me of the Call of Duty a couple of years back.
Was it Riley?
The dog,
Riley.
Yeah. Riley. Where you could
hopefully
give
it doesn't remind
commands.
You too much of Riley.
No, not too much. I mean, they're sort of, they look similar, but not too much. But they said contextual commands.
Better to fuck some shit up.
So it's not quite controlling the dog, but it still looks like the dog is a major component of you navigating the landscape and you surviving, which I think is, okay.
This reminds me of the dog from, the
Fable 2?
No, Ubisoft game about the war. Valiant Hearts, where you can send the dog to go pick things up and get them for you, which looks like you can do a lot.
Earlier on the demo, when they showed off the dog for the first time, picking up that wrench and that sort of area that you had, which we were speculating was where you'd be building weapon parts and building your suit and whatnot. Then they showed off as well the Vats is back, which was
you got your Vats.
Yes, I think a lot of people were probably happy about that. They showed off a lot of Boston as well in this one. They didn't really allude to the scale of the world, but it certainly looked a lot more varied in terms of color palette this time around.
Yeah, I think starting with all the concept art was a very smart thing to do as well, because they could have just dropped you in and you would have been like, oh, well, you know, this is it. But with the concept art that showed the real scale of the different kinds of environments.
Death Claws are back.
Death Claws look so good, too. Look at the way they move like a thing, as opposed to what that Fallout 3 block of... meat.
We saw rad roaches, so we saw rad scorpions, we saw mole rats. On one of the concept art things, there's a Protectatron there. We saw mole rat queen. Look at that, it's like a zombie ass person.
Feral ghoul.
That's what it is. Oh, nope. Oh, Jesus. Yeah.
Nope.
The variety game, I guess they were hammering home the idea of gameplay variety, which has always been a massive pillar for the Fallout games. But look at this shit. Just calling in air support.
And then you're in. It's like, I'm just going to get up there and off. Yeah.
Gosh.
The first game that had for flying in their engine was the...
Killer Teddy Bear.
One of the expansion packs for Skyrim that you fly around. So I guess they pulled that stuff in. Jetpacks.
They showed so much. I don't think I've ever seen a press conference where they've shown this much footage.
I think this is like going in the record books or Hall of Fame or E3 for most... groundbreaking, most impactful conference. Because the sheer amount of volume. Look at this. Take that megaton.
God. Just done. You know what? Like, good on Bethesda for waiting until the game was almost done to announce it.
But
good on them.
But then, they weren't finished. They showed off that big gameplay montage after waxing lyrical about the game forever. Yeah. And then they pull you back in and show you all this stuff. Like,
hey,
they basically.
All the shit we can let you do now.
This is Hearthfire, basically. But. Oh. Yeah. Really expanded.
It's, think about what's happened in the world since. The last Fallout game came out, games like Rust and looking at like online survivor games and not only can you build your own house, but you're building your own community.
Yeah.
And defenses. I mean, it looks like there's going to be some kind of like defense mini game here where you're going to be attacked.
Did you see there was a great tower defense mod for Skyrim that someone made and like I would love if this was a kind of runoff of that.
Mm. So in this, you can build your own house. You can make place to store your Pip-Boys, to store your weapons. You can make terminals and then presumably probably program them. Like, the idea that you could do all this for a house and then also set up electrical things. And they said you had to collect water and food for the people who lived in your Fallout. And all this is actually optional. It's like not necessarily part of the core Fallout 4. Experience.
And now you can carry 40,000 pounds in your inventory.
Have they talked about encumbrance yet?
Not yet, but I have to assume, please, I'll raise it a little bit. This is a lot of crap to carry around.
And there's all these jerks
coming
in.
Look at that! He's made his own artillery. Oh, traps?
Yeah. And if that wasn't enough, then they show off that, apart from going around collecting loot and then building your own world, you can also do the same thing for weapons. And not even any weapons, but weapon components.
Yeah.
Not even weapon components, but power armor. It's, look at this nonsense.
it got really nitty gritty here.
And they're like, oh, you don't have to do any of this stuff. He's like, oh, by the way, this is just there if you kind of want it.
It's all, look, this is all stuff we did. We made this iPhone game on the site. Oh, yeah, by the way, like, you can play video games on the Pip-Boy now.
Oh, my God.
And listen to tapes on the Pip-Boy.
That was like a Donkey Kong kind of game right there. Yeah.
And then just when you thought there wasn't enough of this madness, they announced that an actual physical Pip-Boy is also being made with a touchscreen.
Just stick your phone in that, and suddenly it's like, oh, look at these things.
It's got a touchscreen. It's actually more advanced than the real Pip-Boys. Who's picking one of these up?
Absolutely.
Everyone.
I'll totally get one.
I literally can't even with that Pip-Boy.
I don't even know where what I would do with it. Where would I wear it? Would I wear it?
All day, every day.
Can you imagine? You just think about all the people that walk around San Francisco with Apple Watches on. It could be a
We'd all be walking around with just these Pip Boys all day long.
This is some next level nerddom.
It's
like listening to I Don't Want to See the World on Fire over and over and over. Or Three Dog. You might be able to get Three Dog on it all the time.
Can you? Oh, yeah.
Could just get his own radio station.
Yeah. Suddenly, I don't know.
Oh, my God. And then at the end, they drop the bombshell. I guess 11, 11, 11 was what they did for Skyrim.
Sure. Yeah. So 11, 10, 15.
Vault 111. Yeah.
11, it's 15.
The 10th of November 2015, we'll be able to play Fallout 4. I actually cannot think of an E3 game announcement that's had this much impact. I know it's like the moment afterwards, so we're like caught up in the fervor.
Yeah.
But Kevin, can you think of anything that's been quite as overtaking as this?
No. No, I don't know. What else?
Kevin Van Oort's lost for words. It's finally happened.
What do I qualify it with? It's like, no.
I was about to say, is this better than the Killzone 2 trailer?
Well, because we can believe this. This is actually gameplay we're looking at. This
the only
is
moment
stuff.
That's had like any kind of a similar reaction was the Xbox One PS4 price thing.
Yes, you're
that
right.
Just for the moment of everyone going, no! And that's basically what happened in this war room when they announced the release date.
But I think this was better.
This was better.
Out.
Yeah.
100%.
How many days until November 10th, 2015? 148 days, 4 hours, 24 minutes, and 36 seconds. That's how long we have to wait to play Fallout 4. I don't think there's anything else to say about that.
I'm going to cryostasis now, just so that, like, tomorrow it'll just be here.
Let's all go into cryostasis, but stay tuned to GameSpot.com for continuing coverage of Fallout 4 for the next 148 days. We've also got a bunch of other games to talk about here. Another one they showed off, they started the show off with, actually, was Doom. I was left a bit cold with this one. What did you think, Lucy?
I was excited because they said it was id Tech 6, or 666 as they call it, and I was like, so I was just spending the whole thing like looking at it, and then I was like, it looks pretty.
Didn't look that pretty.
It was okay.
No. What did you think about the locomotion in it, Kevin?
Was it supposed to be fast?
So Doom has always been, it feels way more fast than that to me.
Yeah, like I don't know, like it just felt thing.
I think for the demo though. Mm. I mean, obviously when you play Doom, it is incredibly fast paced and whatever. But I think for a demo, you can't put that on screen because if you're showing off your engine as well, especially for the first time properly, you want to be able to say to people, look at all this crap we built. Like, look at it. Look at how good it looks.
Well, so every
you're not going to appreciate this when you play it. Look at it now.
Every time he lifted up a gun, I was like, oh, look at the gun. Are you getting hard looking at the gun now?
I did like that animation. When you were ripping it off a dead body and the guy was, you know, like there was force behind the guy. I liked that.
So this was the demo they showed afterwards, but the original part of this that they showed off was on a straight up like old Mars base. Like this is definitely based within the same world that they're going for with Doom 3 in terms of the UAC holding a base and then the hellscape opening up. If we can get some footage of that, it'd be great. That whole section that they showed off introduced a bunch of the weapons that were on offer. They showed the shotgun, the super shotgun. Mm-hmm. They also showed off a lot of these contextual deaths that they kept showing. But
a lot of environmental stuff as well.
Was it
like
just
really big explosions by shooting things in the environment, which is cool.
Was it just me or did you guys think that they were repeating a lot of those death sequences over and over again?
I saw quite a few of the one where they rip off the leg and hit him in the head with it. I thought there was a lot of repetitiveness, I think, in the gameplay.
The one where it was just like the leg left standing in the half body.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was like the running. Running. Yeah, it was just a bit.
It's weird because he was plowing through so many of these characters. Like it was almost felt like something like Bulletstorm where you're just soaking these dudes up. And for me, like I know that when you go back and think about Doom 1 and 2 now, they're not the scariest games in the world. But those games had an element of, like, this is hard. Like, it's me up against hordes and hordes of enemies. And if you're setting it right, you're in a difficulty that actually feels like it's challenging. Obviously, they can't, you know, show that off at a conference and have you dying over and over again. But there's something about this that just seemed like, it felt like more like Serious Sam. And Serious Sam was on the ridiculous end of that sort of combat shoot.
Yeah.
I get that. I get that a lot.
I'm just bored by a lot of this, honestly, and I feel bad because I know that some of my Twitter feed was like, oh, it's exciting, and look at all the gore, and then some more of the look at the gore, and also, did you notice the blood? And the And I'm just like, this is first-person shooter, the first-person, like...
This is the first-person shooter.
Like, it's just is what it is, and I just kind of expected more, I guess. It doesn't mean that I don't think a game can just be... It's okay for a game to just be fun, but I'm just looking at it thinking, but what is it that this is bringing me that I can't already get in Painkiller and a bunch of other games that feel very much like this?
It felt to me like the type of game that's been passed through a bunch of different like public like testing and just rounded off, because not only, like, they're returning all these games, like the BF3 1000 whatever is back there. Like, they're showing off the plasma gun, they're showing off all of these guns, and they all looked like the same gray thing. It was basically shooting projectiles. There was no like feeling of, oh, this is like different, like there was in so many of those games. Like Quake 2 is like the best grenades in video game ever. Like the rail gun, you think, like, to me, or this felt more like a Quake. I even said Quake there. This felt more like a Quake in terms of your ability to just mow down tons and tons of enemies. Yeah, I don't know. To me, this didn't feel like a Doom at all.
And I was thinking of Unreal when during moments like this where he's just switching between the different types of weapons and thinking, oh, that's kind of like a little bit like Unreal Tournament. Mm-hmm. So
regardless of our impressions of the gameplay, they showed off some other stuff. Snap Map, which is their new technology
Snapchat
for sending dick pics around the world in Doom. For making levels, which in and of itself is a little bit worrying if they're making modular level design for a game that, you know, invented.
I think that's cool, and that they're trying to introduce that to a new audience, like console especially. I think that's cool. And if the toolkit works and if it's intuitive enough, then people will obviously jump on it. I hope it works.
They showed off some multiplayer things as well. They had a four on four mode in there. They had wave based mode in there. It was about the time I was starting to fall asleep.
You mentioned cooperative modes.
Yes.
Was that the very first one?
And they said 2016 as well. And this is part of, so it's coming out next year. Maybe we'll see more of it. Maybe being a little bit rough on it, I don't know. I came out of that as
probably
a massive Doom fan, thinking that wasn't too hot. Also, this is part of BethesdaNet, which is their new
WB Play.
Because we need more of those.
Exactly, their new Origin, their new BattleNet, which is an online environment in which all of these games will be launchable and whatnot. I don't know. I was glad they finished with Fallout, because for me, the Doom announcement wasn't too hot. Final thoughts on Doom, Alexa?
I don't think I've seen enough to really be like, woo, yet. I mean, it looks fun, but beyond that,
It's there.
It's a game.
All right, I guess we'll have to wait and see. Let us know what you think of Doom in the comments. Are we being a little bit too tough on it? Were you disappointed as well, or did you think it looks pretty badass? Let us know down below. All right, we've got a bunch more games to get through. Next up, Dishonored Dose.
Oh, my God.
Emily Caldwin's back as well. All right, who's the biggest Dishonored fan here?
This girl.
All right, go for it. What do you think?
I'm really excited. I'm really glad that it's not, it's technically, that it picks up from the last game. Like, I really like the world. I was hoping for a prequel, but the idea that you get to play as Emily, who I'm not going to spoil it because they announced Dishonored Definitive Edition.
Oh, they did.
So if you haven't played Dishonored yet, it's coming to PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. So I won't spoil it, but Emily is a very important character from the first game that doesn't get not a lot of the spotlight.
Yeah.
And I'm also very, very excited that they showcased her in the trailer. You can play as Emily or as Corvo, but they focused on her. And it reminded me, I hate to call this out, but it reminded me of the Syndicate reveal, Assassin's Creed Syndicate,
where
you have the male and female playable protagonists, but they led with Jacob, which is the boy. I really liked what I saw.
So you can play as both her and Corvo in it?
Either or, I think. Cool. You get to pick. It looks great. It looks like the world has sort of teched up a little bit. It looks a little bit more evolved from the last game. I'm really excited to see what this goes story-wise, because the narrative was one of my favorite things about Dishonored.
Speaking of that, does this look like the same city, same environment that was in the first game?
Or no, this looks entirely different. Mm. It looks, yeah.
I mean, her outfit. Obviously, it's a CG trailer, so we can't really take too much from it. But it looks thematically similar, but a very, very different aesthetic.
And we were talking before the show went live about how the Dishonored came out and had a great sort of an art style to it, but maybe technically didn't wow us in the ways that we would have hoped, especially probably because of the end of that generation. Those consoles were looking a little bit light in terms of technical prowess. But in terms of gameplay and whatnot here, was there anything else that stood out to you guys in terms of like the weapons, the powers that Emily was wielding?
She's the smoke monster from Lost, apparently.
Yeah, she's got Jackie Estacado's darkness beings or something happening.
It was cool. I mean, obviously, we saw a look at, I think she had the blink, she had the time slowdown. She also has some kind of like grappling hook that we just used to scale across buildings there. And obviously the crossbow, which Corvo used to great effect. Oh, there it is. It seems to come out of her.
Yeah, it looks like wrists. It comes from like prototype or something like that.
But yeah, it looks cool, and I mean, I'm just excited to see more, really.
We don't have a date on this one as of yet, but they said that...
No, they didn't say spring.
No, they said... No. Did they say anything?
No, that was spring. I was looking at the wrong notes.
PC, Xbox, PlayStation.
And Dishonored Definitive Edition, which, interestingly enough, who called this out? And there was somebody who said it to us beforehand. Yes, Phil Wade 75 before the show said, "Do you think there'll be a Dishonored remaster?" Yeah, called it. So we're gonna have an HD version of Dishonored coming out to PlayStation 4, Xbox One. Did they say PC for that one as well?
Yes, they did.
They did. All right, so you can play your HD. You can finally play Dishonored in HD later on this year. And that's pretty much all that happened here at the Bethesda conference. Some other little bits and bobs. Dishonored was probably another one of the biggest games at it. For continuing coverage of Dishonored and all the other games Bethesda shown off here and all the games we're going to have at E3, make sure you stay tuned to GameSpot.com. All right. That's it. Day one done.
Already?
That was crazy.
Amazing.
Can we go?
Nuts!
I'm going to go watch the replay of that Fallout thing a couple more times. Kevin Van Ord, Lucy James, Alexa Ray-Korea, thank you so much for joining me today.
Always.
Stay tuned to GameSpot. We'll be back. What time tomorrow morning?
Early.
8 a.m. Microsoft.
Oh, my God.
That's where I have to be. Yeah. So maybe 9. Maybe 9 Pacific. Change it for your own local time. But, of course, on GameSpot.com/E3, we have all the times of all the press conferences. Big day tomorrow, live at 8:30 in the morning. So make sure you wake up early and check us out then. But until then, if you're in Europe, go to bed. Well done for staying up. If you're in the States, get some early rest because we've got a big day of video games coming up tomorrow. Thanks to everyone in the production team, and we'll see you guys tomorrow. Take care.